Well, good morning, everybody. Good to see you today. We have some empty seats here today. We'll get around to that in just a few minutes, but I sure am glad to see you. Amen. All right, we got a few songs we're going to sing for you this morning.
There's a dark and a troubled side of life. There's a bright and sunny side too. Though we meet in the darkness of strife, there's a sunny side we'll always make you. Keep on sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life. It will help us every day, it will brighten all your way, if you'll keep on the sunny side of life.
Hey, Dan, you're going to have to move your guitar to the scene.
Let us greet with a song of hope each day. Though the moments be cloudy and fair, let us trust in our Savior always to keep us everyone in His care. Keep on the sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life. It will help us every day, it will brighten all the way, if we'll keep on the sunny side of life. If we'll keep on the sunny side of life.
Amen.
Good to have Bob back with us. Amen. Yes, sir. Hi, Bob.
Welcome home, Bob.
I was trying to tell Dan his guitar neck was in the way and I couldn't see the words over here. He's just looking at me like, what's wrong with you? Amen.
The thief was down to his last breath there on Calvary. When he turned to the Master,
yes,
and said, Lord, have mercy on me. He
was just a broken vessel when Jesus washed away his sin. And there's not a broken vessel God can't mend. There's not a broken vessel God can't mend.
Amen.
When the whole world turns its back on you, he will be your friend. He'll pick up the pieces,
yes,
time and time again, 'cause there's not a broken vessel God can mend. Jesus is the potter, we're just the clay. Even when we're broken, he doesn't throw us away. So bring him all your heartache, your troubles and your sin, 'cause there's not a broken vessel God can mend. There's not a broken vessel God can't mend. When the whole world turns its back on you, he will be your friend. He'll pick up the pieces time and time again, 'cause there's not a broken vessel God can't mend. He'll pick up the pieces time and time again, 'cause there's not a broken vessel God can't make.
Amen. I fly away to heaven, I won't fail when the angels carry me home. I want to see Jesus first of all when the angels carry me home. When the angels carry me home. When the angels carry me home. I want to see Jesus first of all when the angels carry me home. No more sorrow, no more pain when the angels carry me home. I'll ride that heavenly glorious train when the angels carry me home. When the angels carry me home. When the angels carry me home. I want to see Jesus first of all when the angels carry me home.
Hey.
I'm on my pathway leading to heaven when the angels carry me home. I'll see my Jesus waiting for me when the angels carry me home. When the angels carry me home. When the angels carry me home. I want to see my Jesus first of all when the angels carry me home. Want to see my Jesus first of all when the angels carry me home.
you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you reach each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Let's stand as we sing on that third verse, when the bridegroom comes, singing. When the bridegroom cometh, will your robes be white? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansions bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Tim was praying for the offering, and I just told the Lord, God, I'm glad I know you.
Amen. Yes.
Lord, I'm glad I know you.
Yes, sir.
And another thing, I'm glad He knows me.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. Page 24. The old song, you'll know this one, the old rugged cross. We'll do the first and the last. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross, and
ahead and do verse number 2, singing. All the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. Last verse, to the old rugged cross, I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory for
someday I'm going to heaven, a place never been, and I'll live up there forever in a world that I never shall end. Thank God I'll have a new body, I'll live forevermore. I'll sing and shout with the angels over on that beautiful shore. So many clouds are gathering, sometimes I can't hardly see. But I caught a glimpse of heaven, and oh, what a sight I did see. I can see the saints all gathering, all around God's great white throne. Thank God I am so happy, I'll soon be going home. I can hardly wait for tomorrow when we'll all be together again. I'll get to see my mother when he says, my child, come on in. We'll stroll through the hills of glory, we'll be singing a brand new song. We'll all be so happy, thank God I'm on my way home. So many clouds are gathering, sometimes I can't hardly see. But I caught a glimpse of heaven, and oh, what a sight I did see. I can see the saints all shouting, all around God's great white throne. Thank God I am so happy, I'll soon be going home. Thank God I am so happy, I'll soon be going home.
I remember standing at my daddy's bedside, and the tears filled up the wrinkles on his face. As I held his withered hand, he smiled and whispered, "Son, I'm going to live in a better place, and I'll have eyes that will never fill with teardrops. Amen. And I'll have legs that will never ache with pain. And I'll have hands that will never age or wither. And a heart that will never break again. I have often heard and read about a city where with Jesus we shall live forevermore. And a mansion in construction for my dwelling, and a street of gold will run by my front door. Yes. And I'll have eyes that will never fill with teardrops, and I'll have legs that will never ache with pain. And I'll have hands that will never age and wither, and a heart that will never break again. And I'll have eyes that will never fill with teardrops, and I'll have legs that will never ache with pain.
Yes, come on.
And I'll have hands that will never age and wither, and a heart that will never break again. And I'll have hands that will never age and wither, and a heart that will never break again.
Amen.
I'm holding a very special microphone in my hand this morning.
Yes.
Yes. Amen. Yes. This is the microphone that Manny sings out of every week for us, to the glory of God. She don't sing for herself, she sings to the glory of God. For those of you that's watching by video, you're probably wondering where she's at. Well, I'll tell you where she's at today. And I say this because her husband, Troy Early, told me yesterday to make this announcement. He wants everybody who hears this message to pray for his wife, Manny Early. Go to God in prayer today, please, for this precious saint of God. She's at the Methodist Hospital this morning right now, and she's trying to recover from many things that's gone wrong for a basic, simple surgery. Troy told me that yesterday. He told me, he said, "I thought we would be in church tomorrow." That's just how simple the surgery was supposed to have been. But things have gone wrong, and we've had our ups and downs. She had a good night last night, and this morning while I was traveling to church, I got a text message from her son. Said that she opened her eyes this morning and she was responding to a few commands. I sent back a text message and I said, "Tell Manny that I love her. And after church, I'm going to come up and see her." And she nodded her head. She's got she has a ventilator and she can't speak right now. So I want you to pray for Maney early today, and I want you to pray for Troy. His heart is so broken today. He said, I don't care, Brother Tim, where you put this. Put it on YouTube. Put it on Facebook. Put it everywhere you can. Let everybody know. Pray for Maney early. We want Maney to be back. She's ready to go to heaven, okay? There's no question about that. But I'm just being selfish today. I want her to come back here and sing for us. Amen. And not only that, but we've got a lot of other names on our prayer list today that need our special attention, ladies and gentlemen. There's a man by the name of Fred Forshee that's been in the hospital for a little while. A friend of Mr. Doug Thompson has brought to my attention, and we need to pray for this individual today. Brother Gary Dean Hudson has not been with us now for several weeks, and he's having his ups and downs. Miss Lena Yeary, who sits on the very back row, she's losing so much weight, and she's only able to eat soups and Ensure and things like that. And we need to take these people to God in prayer and ask Him to touch their bodies today. Brother Don Clark, who sits right over here in the third row back, has been in the hospital for 2 days. I just found this out today. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please listen to your pastor this morning? If you need to go to the hospital, would you please let me know? I want to know. If you don't want me to tell everybody else, that's okay. But please let me know so I know how to pray for you. Please. I'm your pastor and I love you. You're my sheep of this flock and I want to care for you the best I can. So please let me know. Brother Don needs our prayer today and so does Miss Lorraine. She's very upset today. So please pray for her. Pray for Chrissy Swales. This is Miss Judy Branham's daughter. She was in a hospital. She's been sent home under Judy's care. And so we need to pray for Miss Judy this morning. I see my mother-in-law, Miss Shirley, out here with us today. She's been having a lot of back pains here lately. And I want you to pray for her today. I want you to pray that God would touch her and raise her up. I see names on this prayer list we have on the back of our bulletin, and I would urge you and I would ask you to please go over these names throughout the week. They're not on there just to fill up space. They're on there because they've asked us to put their name on there that we would pray for them. I'm going to ask you this morning, let's do something very special today. We don't do very often, but those of you who are able and you would like to come up front, I want us to gather up around the front of the building here, and I want us to pray together for all these names today. If you can, if you'd like to come and help me pray, let's just come right now, if you will, please. I'm believing God to touch these folks. Maney keeps coming up with infection, and she's had 4 surgeries. Monday or Tuesday, they're going to do another surgery on her. And they're trying to repair what's happened. But she keeps setting up infection. And so we want to pray that this infection, that God would just rebuke it and it would not come back. And I believe we serve a God who's able to do that. Amen. I see Miss Lawson over here. And I'm so glad Miss Lawson's with us today. God bless you, Brother Kenny and Miss Kathy, for making sure she's here every week. God bless you, sister. You cheer my heart when I see you here. Everybody cheers my heart when I see you here, but I know a lot of you come when you're not feeling well. It speaks volumes to me. I just love you to pieces, and I know you love Jesus, and He loves you, and I just want us to pray. Thank you, Miss Reba, for continuing to play the piano for me. I know you would join us up here had I not asked you to sit there. But let's just go to the Lord in prayer. I want you just to pray the best way you know how. And I want you to reach heaven today and ask God to touch Maney and all these other names that we've mentioned here. And I'm going to believe God to do that today. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you today. And God, we pray for our dear sister, Miss Maney Early. God, I ask you that you would touch her, Lord. I ask you, God, you'd raise her up today, Lord. I pray, God, that you'll bring a healing into her body like she's never seen before. From the inside out, God, I want you to touch her, Jesus. Walk into that room right now, God, and I pray that the surgeons and all of the nurses would be astonished at what they would see today, God.
And Father, I believe in the name of Jesus that you're able to do this. And God, we look to you this morning. God, we cannot look to anyone else, God. There's no other power except your power that can heal her the way she needs to be healed. And God, I'm asking you to do that today. And I pray you touch Troy today and lift him up, God, and encourage his heart and bless their sons today. And God, I pray that you'll bless every name that we've mentioned here today, Father. I pray for Brother Gary Dean Hudson this morning at home, that God, that you would just walk into his house right now, Father, and that you would touch him, Lord, and he would know that your presence is there. And God, I pray for Chrissy Swales today, Father, you'd touch her, and that you would give Miss Judy the strength that she needs, Father. And Lord, I pray for Lena Yeary today, God, please be with Miss Lena. I pray that the doctors would get her into the office sooner than what they expected, Lord. And I pray they had properly diagnosed her, Lord, and be able to get her where she needs to be. And God, I'm thankful to see Miss Pearl with us today. And I know, Father, that she needs a touch from heaven today. And I ask you, God, to touch her, Lord. And I pray for Fred, for she, Lord, that you would be with him today, Lord, in that hospital. And Father, all these names I look through, people dealing with cancers today, Lord, and dementia and Alzheimer's. And Father, I pray that, God, you'd raise them up, Lord, and renew their mind, renew their strength to them today. God. Lord, we need you today. And God, if you don't do it, Lord, then, Father, they won't be with us much longer. So, Father, please, in the name of Jesus, touch their heart. And God, thank you for these precious folks that's come forward here today, Lord, that they would pray, seeking the face of God on behalf of these folks that need our prayer. Help Don Clark today, Father. Be with him in that hospital room. Be with Lorraine. Heavenly Father, I pray, oh God, you'll touch your people here at Graceway. I know folks are here today that don't feel well. And I pray that you would raise them up in this service. And Father, we'll give you the glory. We'll give you the praise. For God, we'll know that it came from heaven, that touch. Thank you, God. Lord, my heart hurts today, God, for these folks. I love them so much, and I know you do too. God, some of them couldn't even make it to church today, God. And you know why? Wherever they're at right now, Lord, please touch them. God, I just feel like I don't want to leave today until I know that you have, Lord. Oh, God. Lord, we understand that we live in a fallen world. We know, God, we're going to age, we're going to get old, we're going to have problems, we're going to leave this life until Jesus comes. Lord, I'm just being selfish right now, I guess. And I just pray, God, that you'll touch our precious flock. Lord, we praise you for that. God, I was so glad to see Brother Bob here this morning. I put my arms around him and I told him I loved him, and I was so glad he's here. We missed him so much when he wasn't here, God. And Lord, you touched him, you raised him up, and you made it where he could be here today. Thank you for Miss Lawson and Miss Shirley being here, God. Touch their hearts today, Father. And Jesus, we'll give you the praise for these things. We ask it all in your name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Yes, sir. Amen, brother. Amen. If you didn't hear that, Brother Bob just wanted to thank everybody for all the prayers that was prayed for him, for allowing him to be here today. Whew. You guys pray this microphone to be held in the hands of Maney real soon now, okay? Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Miss Reba. God is so good, isn't he? God's just good, isn't he? I serve a risen Savior, folks. If he wasn't risen, boy, we couldn't be here today, could we? If he hadn't gone to the cross of Calvary and paid for my sin and your sin and went to that grave and was raised up, we'd have nothing to preach about, would we? We'd have nothing to live for, would we? We'd have nothing to ask for healing for, would we? Brother, I tell you what, I'm so glad that I've been healed by His stripes. Amen? Yeah. I'm talking about that spiritual healing. And that's what that passage is talking about. Oh, I tell you, folks, I'm glad that Jesus went to the cross of Calvary. I'm so glad that I know Him in my heart today. I'm so glad that when I went to the hospital yesterday, I laid there and I looked at a godly woman laying there fighting for a life that knows Jesus. And hey, if God decides to take her out, it's okay with her. She's going to go to heaven. Amen. And I hope that everybody in this room today has that assurance. And if you don't, you need to have that assurance today. Amen. Because listen, we don't know at any given moment. We could stroke out. We could have a heart attack. We could pass out, hit our head. We could trip in our home. We could knock ourselves out. We could never recover. And ladies and gentlemen, you need to make sure today that you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior today. Amen. Because if you don't, you'll leave this world unprepared to stand before God. And when you stand there, He'll judge you for the sin that you've been living in. Amen. But if you know Jesus Christ, your sins are not going to be remembered. Jesus paid that price for you and for me. Amen. And brother, when we stand before God, we'll stand there with a clear record. Amen. Because of the Lamb of God that died for us and rose from the dead for us. Amen. Well, praise God. Brother, I tell you, it's a joy to go to funerals when people you know are in heaven today. Amen. Yes. I did one yesterday. What a precious saint of God. Well, amen. If you got your Bible, go to the book of Nehemiah this morning. Book of Nehemiah. It's in the Old Testament right after Ezra. As far as I know, that's all I can tell you. Amen. Page 541 of my Bible. Book of Ezra. Thank you, Lord. I appreciate everybody that's here in this building today and everybody listening on our video audience. I appreciate you today, and we desire your prayers here at Graceway Fellowship Church. Amen. Book of Nehemiah, chapter number one. The Bible begins by saying, the words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaiah, and it came to pass in the month of Kislev, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the palace, Hanani, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews which had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also was broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your holy word today. Father, I ask you, Lord, that you would fill this vessel, Father, standing at this pulpit today. I pray, Lord, that you'll put words in my mouth I didn't plan on saying today, God. I pray, Lord, that you would preach your message through me today to the people of Graceway. For those who are listening, Father, we make them welcome today through the video. And I pray that their hearts would be blessed. And I pray whoever might be listening, if they would be unsaved, we would ask you today, Father, you deal with their heart, Holy Spirit, as they hear the word of God, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray that as they feel that convicting power, they would confess Jesus as Lord and be saved. And I pray for Christians, Lord, that are going through battles and trials and tribulations, that God would be encouraged in our hearts today. And Father, we'll thank you for these things, and I pray it and ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Today, I want to talk to us about broken walls and gates burned with fire. Broken walls and gates burned with fire. In about 586 B.C., the Jews were taken captive by King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. God's judgments fell on Israel for their sins of idolatry and rebellion against Him because they disobeyed God's commands and laws. And so God allowed the Babylonian Empire as the agent that He would use for judgment against Israel.
And during this time of captivity, Jerusalem was attacked over a whole year, and many people were killed. Solomon's temple was destroyed, and many Jews were taken into captivity. The city of Jerusalem was left in ruins. Not only was the temple destroyed, but the walls of Jerusalem were fallen. Israel would be in captivity now for 70 years. Then the only remnant would return, then only a small remnant, I should say, would return to Jerusalem. And you can read about this in the book of 2 Chronicles and 2 Kings. But in our text today, we see the burden of Nehemiah for the remnant of the children of Israel who are returning to Jerusalem, and his burden to repair the broken walls and the gates that were burned with fire. Years have passed since the remnant has returned to Jerusalem now, and Nehemiah, in his writing, he says that he was in the palace when his brother Hanani came to him, and Nehemiah asked him, how would you like to, his parents, Hananiah Nehemiah and Hanani. Boy, I tell you what, how about just Misty and Sarah? That works for me. But years have passed now, and so his brother Hanani comes to him, and Nehemiah asks him what's going on in Jerusalem, and Hanani's response is that they are in great affliction and reproach. In other words, the situation, ladies and gentlemen, is malignant. There's much evil that has fallen on them, and it is displeasing to the eye to see what's happening, and they are living now in extreme poverty, shame, and disgrace. And may I remind you this morning, this is exactly the place that the devil himself would love to place you and I, in much disgrace, in a malignant state, with extreme poverty, shame, and disgrace. That's his plan, that's his will for every born-again believer that's here. And those that are outside of Christ, he feels like he's got you there already, and you are poverty-stricken without the Lord Jesus Christ. Hanani goes on with the news, and he says that the walls of Jerusalem are broken down and the gates are burned with fire. When Nehemiah heard these words, the Bible said that he sat down and he wept. For a few days he mourned and he fasted and he prayed to God. When he prayed to God, he said, God, hear my prayer and open your eyes to us. We have sinned against you. We have been corrupt and have not kept your commandments. And Nehemiah is reminded that if they would turn from God, that God said, I will scatter you into other nations. But if you would obey the Lord God and his commands, that God would regather you. Now get this. This is very important. Nehemiah says to God, God, these are your servants, and say your people to whom you have redeemed, everybody say redeemed, by your great power and your strong hand, Lord, grant them mercy. Ladies and gentlemen, we are talking about the people of God that Nehemiah is praying for, and he's reminding God who they are. They're your children. They are the folks that you have redeemed, God. Nehemiah is the cupbearer of the palace to the king. Now, this was a high office where he filled the cup and delivered the cup personally to the king. Now, Nehemiah, as a cupbearer, he is to make sure that the cup does not have any poison. In other words, he's the taster. He makes sure that there's no poison in the cup. Now, I want you to know, it's not in your bulletin today, but it will be next week, about this important job of being a cupbearer. But we're going to have a business meeting on the last Wednesday night of this month at 6 p.m., okay? That'll be in your bulletin next week. You'll see that. But I'm going to make a motion now. I want you to pray about it and consider it, that I'm going to ask for Brother Mike Hargis to be my cupbearer. Amen. And every pastor needs a cupbearer. So I see how much we can trust him. Amen. Glory to God. But, amen. He told me I could pick on him today, so that's what I'm doing. Amen. But anyway, so Nehemiah, the cupbearer, he takes the cup to the king, and the king looks upon his countenance and said, why are you so sad, Nehemiah? I know that you're not feeling bad. And Nehemiah said, he honors the king, and he says, let the king live forever.
Why should I not be so sad because of the city where my father's grave lieth? It lies in waste, and the gates are consumed with fire. The king kindly answered and said, Nehemiah, what is your request? And the next line, it's in verse number 4, Nehemiah says, so I prayed to the God of heaven. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something. When the gates are getting burned in your life and the walls are beginning to fall down, it is time that we go to God in prayer, amen. It is time that we call upon the God of the universe, as we did this morning, for those that we know, that we love and we care for. They need God today, amen. And brother, they're relying on us that we would go to the throne of grace and mercy. And brother, the Bible says that we can go boldly today to the throne of grace, and we can ask God, we can plead for God that He would touch their lives, amen. And brother, I believe He'll do it, amen. I believe God can do it and will do it. We'll seek His face and ask Him to do great things, amen. Glory to God. He said, I prayed to the God of heaven. In the following text, Nehemiah had asked the king for permission to leave from the palace and allow him to go to Jerusalem and rebuild the walls. Now listen, there are hundreds of sermons, and I've heard a lot of them, about Nehemiah and the building of the wall of Jerusalem. But today, I want us to stay where we're at in chapter number 1, and I want us to look at the broken wall and the gates that are burned with fire. Brother and sister, I hope you realize that we live on planet Earth today, amen? We live in a place that's described as fallen. What that means is that there is sin in this world, amen? And sin and the world is coming at us at 100 miles an hour while we are in Christ, amen? We are in Christ. He is in us. But brother, we still face the same opposition that the world without Jesus Christ faces. Have you noticed that lately? Amen. I mean, if the United States gets attacked by another country, we're included, just like the guy across the street. Amen. We're going to be attacked too. We all have trials and tribulations. In other words, we have our gates, the gates of our life are attacked, and sometimes they get burned, and the walls in our Jerusalem begin to fall down and crumble. Hanani said that the gates were burned with fire. There were in old Jerusalem, there were 10 gates, and they all had a particular meaning. It's a very interesting study. You should look it up and read about them. But I won't mention them all today, but there's one that is significant, and it is called the Sheep Gate. It is where that the sheep were led into the city for sacrifice. Now, we're reminded today, the Sheep Gate speaks to us as the cross of Calvary. Amen. That's where the Lamb of God went and made the ultimate once for all. I said once for all, yeah. Glory to God, sacrifice that we can all be saved through Him. Amen. And that is the starting point for us today. That's where everything starts for our faith today, is at the cross. Amen. Be reminded that John the Baptist said of Jesus when he saw Him at the River Jordan, behold the Lamb of God which taketh away the sin of the world. Now listen to me this morning, Mr. and Mrs. Born Again Believer, that's great news. Did you hear what I said? The Lamb of God has taken away the sin of the world, amen? Taken it away. He didn't just cover it over, but He took it away. That's what John the Baptist is saying. We should rejoice today, Mr. and Mrs. Believer, that the Lamb of God took that sin away. By the way, Mr. and Mrs. Lost Person today, you need to rejoice the same way, knowing that your sin has been taken away by the Lamb of God. It's only up to you now to believe upon the Word of God, to believe that the Lamb of God has done that for you. If you will believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved. That's what the Bible says. Now, what does that mean to believe? That means I cast myself at the feet of Jesus. I cast myself solely upon Him, asking Him, trusting Him, believing Him to be the Lamb of God, the Son of God, the resurrected Lamb of God. Amen. Yes. When you trust Him that way and you look to Him and know that He paid for your sin, you can say, Lord, I believe that You are the Son of God. I believe You died for me. I believe that You rose from the dead by the power of God. Save me. And He will do it. But you've got to believe, amen. If you don't believe, you'll split hell doubly wide open, amen.
and that's nothing to cheer about. But I'm telling you that you can rejoice today knowing sin has been put away, taken away, and sent away on your behalf today. Yes. And you don't have to live that way anymore. You can trust Him. Now listen to me. Don't let that statement blind you. As I said, if you have not believed upon the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're still in your sin, and you must be saved before you can go to heaven. Amen. You know, I know people today that have gone through major events in their life. Perhaps some of you are sitting here in this auditorium today. These events have left some of those folks in a place where they said, my faith has been shaken. Maybe you've been in that place before where you felt like your faith had been shaken. May I remind you that in Nehemiah's prayer, he was reminding God that Israel were his servants, the people that he had delivered. So I'm addressing Christian, born-again people this morning who say their faith has been shaken because things didn't quite work out the way that you thought they should. Anybody ever had that happen to them? It's all right to raise your hand. You don't have to be bashful this morning. You're among friends, amen? You thought God was for you in the beginning, and now you're wondering if he even knows your name. Amen. God, do you know who I am, Lord? I'm still out here, God. Dear sir or Miss Lady, your gate has been burned with the seed of doubt and disappointment. Wouldn't you agree? Amen. Can I gently remind you this morning what happened to you the moment you said to Jesus, I do? Now, why did I say I do? It's like this. It's because when you said to Jesus, Lord, save me, in a sense, you were saying, I do. You know what that meant? I've only heard those words said a couple times. That means you just got married. Amen. Amen. And we are married to Jesus Christ. Amen. And that's why there's going to be a marriage supper of the Lamb. Amen. Brother, we are married to Christ. And let me tell you something. He will never give us papers of divorcement. Amen. Isn't that good? Listen, the gate of your faith has gone through tasks and many trials. There's been days of struggle. It's all over the map what you maybe have had to deal with on a daily basis. The Apostle Paul said that he died daily. This means that he was faced with adverse situations where his life was threatened on a daily basis, ladies and gentlemen. Why? For spreading the gospel. Why? For telling people about a resurrected Jesus Christ. That's the only reason Paul was executed, because he talked about a man that was risen from the dead who lives forever, and his name is Jesus. Paul had been shipwrecked 3 times. Can you look back on your life and see those days, remember those times that you were shipwrecked in your life? I'm talking about as a born-again believer. Things just didn't quite work out, did they? And you look back and say, this is shipwreck. Yeah. Paul had been bitten by a poisonous snake, and he shook it off. Hey, man, he shook it off. How many times have you been bitten by the poison darts of somebody calling your name in a negative way? Maybe a friend turned against you and turned away from you. Maybe somebody did you wrong. Brother, do like the apostle did. Shake it off, because it cannot really harm you anyway. Amen. God knows who you are. God knows your character. God knows what you're about. Paul had been stoned and left for dead. Sometimes I felt like I'd been stoned a little bit. Amen. But you know what Paul did? Paul continued his journey, refusing to let the gate of his faith be burned, because he remembered the day that he was on that road to Damascus with papers in his hand to accuse the church and to persecute the church. But then a light came out of heaven brighter than the noonday sun, and it struck him to the ground, and that light was the light of Jesus saving him from his sin. And Paul never forgot walking through that first gate of faith. Amen. Go back to the place when Jesus saved you and made you his child. Oh, I tell you, folks, I can remember that night just as plain as I can remember right now when I got down on my knees and I said, Jesus, would you please save me? Amen. Jesus said, I do. Amen. I got married about 12 years old, amen, to the Lord Jesus, and I'm so thankful for that. Glory to God, folks. It's a real thing to be married to the Lamb of God, amen. I love the testimony, you should read it sometime, of Dr. Charles Wagle. He authored the hymn, No One Ever Cared For Me Like Jesus. I didn't realize this, but he was actually born in Lafayette, Indiana in 1871. He talks about his life, and he was growing up as just a mean kid. He caused a lot of people a lot of trouble. In fact, he stabbed his older brother one time. As he got saved at the age of 12,
Later on in life, he realized that he had a talent for writing songs. And during his ministry, there were many times that it took him away on long campaigns away from his wife and his child at home. And you maybe have heard me tell the story. When he came home from one of those campaigns, he found a note on the table, and it said, "Charlie, I don't want to live this life of an evangelist's wife any longer. I want to go live my own life, and I'm taking our child, and I'm leaving. I'm never coming back." Dr. Charles Weigel was so brokenhearted that several times he had entertained the thought of suicide. But you know what? Over time, ladies and gentlemen, his spiritual faith was gradually restored. He soon became active again in his preaching and his singing. And one day when he was sitting at the piano, he wrote these beautiful words: "I would love to tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so strong and true. I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me." Yeah. Amen. Oh, brother, the enemy has come and tried to burn the gates of our faith so that our walls around our Jerusalem will fall. Ladies and gentlemen, we need to be aware of what that lion is doing this morning. He is coming around and roaring at us. But let me tell you one thing he can't do. He cannot sink his teeth in you because you belong to Jesus. And the Bible says that greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. Amen. Amen. Glory to the Lamb of God. We must come to the realization that life and death are going to occur. Someone said you don't get out of here alive. Well, so far that's true. Amen. But one of these days, oh, blessed be the Lamb, the rapture is going to take place. I don't care who don't believe that. I believe that because that's what the Bible said. Amen. That is what the Bible said. Amen. The rapture is going to happen. We'll be out of here in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, when that voice that sounds like a trumpet says, "Come up hither." Amen. And we're going to leave this place, ladies and gentlemen. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Listen to me. One of these days we're going to leave this place, but until then, life happens. Troubles come. Temptations are real. And our gates get burnt at times. Amen. I've noticed over the years there are several reasons why gates of faith get burnt. Some reasons are fairly petty, in my opinion. Amen. Let's read some mail here. Someone gets their feelings hurt by another believer. Have you ever seen that happen? Amen. Misunderstood communications. When I see things like this happen, I think to myself, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? Gee whiz, ladies and gentlemen. I'm busy trying to grow in grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Don't trouble me with petty stuff. I'll just lay that out there right now. Don't bother me with petty stuff. Come to me about the real things that really matter. Amen. Amen.
Yes, amen.
I've lost you now, haven't I? Some people get offended, don't they, over the least little thing. You know, we're not to be idle just waiting for the next offense to happen, are we? We're to be graduating from milk and start eating the meat to grow by. Amen. Oh, what am I saying? What are you saying, Pastor Tim? I'm saying this right here is the meat of the Word of God. And I, you know what? I'm just sold on this. The more that we learn about Jesus, who He is, the more we're going to grow in grace and knowledge about Him. And brother, when we're learning about Him, nothing else is really going to matter because offenses, they're going to happen anyway. Amen? I'd rather just be entertained with Jesus than to worry about somebody not liking me and somebody saying something about me. Amen? I'm at a place I just don't care anymore. Amen? When I was in my 20s and 30s and 40s and sometimes in the 50s, I was a little concerned about it. But anymore, brother, I'm leaving this place. This ain't my home. Yeah. This is not my home. Amen. And what the world says about me doesn't matter. They're not going to go to heaven with me anyway. Yeah. They choose not to. Now, I don't mean to sound ugly when I say that. I'm just saying I've made my preparations. I'm going to go to heaven. Yeah. And I'm going to go to a place where everybody loves me. Amen? Yeah. Everybody. All nationalities are going to be up there in heaven. And we're all going to love each other. Amen? Yeah. We're not going to have any offense toward anybody up there. Amen? That's why it's called heaven. Amen? So are you wondering now what this message is about? Well, so am I. So if you're wondering what this message is about, for real, I want to tell you. The old hymn in our songbook says, there are souls to rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light, send the light, send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Let us pray that grace may everywhere abound. Send the light, and the Christ-like spirit. Everywhere be found. Send the light, amen. You know what? I know there's some people today that I need to go up to them and send some light to them, amen. Glory! I'm not talking about sending the missions across the sea. Brother, we got a mission right here in America. We got a mission right here in Mooresville, amen. We got a mission all around us. Send the light, amen. The light of Jesus Christ. People's got gates that are burned in their lives. Their walls are crumbling down all around them. They need somebody to come in with light, amen. And we got the light because we are the light. We got Jesus in us today. Amen. We're talking about the souls of men and women and boys and girls. I don't have time to let my gate of faith be burnt with offense. None of us do. Why is that? Because when the gate of faith gets burnt, and that's the gate of faith we entered into, amen, discouragement's going to come, and those that we love and hold dear, they're not yet saved, they're in greater danger because we're not sending the light. The next thing they may witness is our walls of Jerusalem falling down around us. Watching our faith crumble is not what they need to see. Amen. Nehemiah was reminding God how he had redeemed the children of Israel with his strong hand. And I would to God this morning that my wife and my children will never see me crumble in my faith and my walls crumble down around me. I preached at a funeral yesterday. What a joy it was to preach on this lady of faith. She had the fullness of God living in her. She loved Jesus. She had fought a long, hard battle. And all the time that I met her in the hospital, and that's the only place I got to meet her. For some of you who don't remember, it was Cheryl Glaspie and her husband Brian. They came and they sat back there about where Brother David is this morning. That was the only service they got to come to. Right after that, she got sick and went to the hospital. That was a week before Thanksgiving last year. She never got to come home until 2 weeks ago in hospice care. And then Jesus came to her house and took her to heaven this past week. Every time I went to see her in the hospital, she was always, always praising the Lord, thanking God, no matter what her situation was. And you know what? She did for me, as I said this yesterday, she did for me what only people in her situation can do at that time. She blessed me. She said, Pastor Tim, every time you come to see me, I like it because you make me feel calm. I walked out of there 10 feet tall thinking, God, thank you for what she said. God, I needed that today. And God, I was reminded that it's worth it, amen, to keep going, keep visiting, keep calling, keep preaching, keep going at it, amen, because people are letting you know that's what they're needing, amen. Yes, amen. Brother, that's a light, amen. That's a light we spread. There are walls that have fallen. Some people's walls of Jerusalem are broken down. The gates to their lives have been burned with fire. I've heard this said more than once. Listen to me. Marijuana has been said to be the gate that many use that leads to the use of hard drugs. After hearing that statement, I thought this week, isn't it interesting that marijuana is burned with fire? It's a gate that's burned with fire that leads to much worse, and then walls begin to fall. There's been some great men in the Bible that had their burnt gates and fallen walls. This week I got an email from Dr. Larry Branham. You might know him better as Dr. Larry Lilly. He wrote this in his latest email article. He said, I'm quoting now, John the Baptist was a giant in the faith. He leaped in his mother's womb when he heard the news of the coming Messiah. Years later, as he was baptizing, he announced the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Later, he stood his ground in convictions against King Herod, knowing it could cost him his life, of which it did. Before his execution, John the Baptist had a question. He sent his disciples to ask Jesus a question. When the men had come to Jesus, they said, "John the Baptist has sent us to ask you a question. Are you the coming one, or do we look for another?" What are you saying, John the Baptist? He was asking if Jesus is really the Messiah. Do you see that? So often, I continue, often as we walk with Jesus, things go wrongfully well. But remember the depression of Elijah under the juniper bush. And now, John the Baptist in Herod's prison. Life can get you down. When it does, take it to Jesus swiftly. A modern song says, "Are you weary? Are you heavy-hearted? Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus alone." Most of us need a new touch today because yesterday is gone. And I'd say that John the Baptist had his gate burnt and his walls coming down, but Jesus restored everything in that message. Amen? And his message back to John, he said, "You go back and tell John the Baptist that the blind receive their sight and the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed and the deaf hear, the dead are raised up and the poor have the gospel preached to them, and blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me." End of quote. Amen?
Yes.
I've seen the walls of believers' lives fall. In fact, I told you about a time in my life when my walls fell. You know all about that. I went through a time like Nehemiah. I went through a time of assessing everything, and then I began to pray. The Holy Spirit reminded me that God, I had the salvation sent from God, and it was still intact. God did care for me. I learned that. And I discovered I wanted to come back. And you want to know something? There's people listening to me on the video. They've been away. And in their spirit, they want to come back. You might know somebody today. Maybe a friend or a colleague or a family member, they'd really like to come back. These are people listening to us today. They're watching us. And you know what? They're just waiting for the invitation to rebuild those walls and repair those gates that have been burnt to their Jerusalem. Since the walls have fallen around them, the gates have been burnt, and they've gone through so much pain and so much discouragement. Many have been told, "Well, you can come on back, but now you got a bloody nose, and God's going to use you, but you know, I'm sorry, but God won't be able to use you like He could have used you in a greater capacity." I want you to listen to me very closely. You come on back right now. You come back to the Father because He's got a ring He wants to put on your finger. He's got a coat He wants to put on you. He wants to put new shoes on you. He's going to go kill a fatted calf because He's going to be glad you came home. And let me tell you something about you don't know about right now. You are more equipped right now than you ever was before because you've been to your school. You've been through your life. You've been through your trials. Your gates have been burned. Your walls have come down. And now God can use you in a greater way than He ever could before. Amen. Brother, I tell you something. I know what I'm talking about here. I know what I'm talking about. You just come on back home. We're ready for you. Amen. God's ready to use you. I'll go on record and say this as well. Sometimes in our spiritual life, it is beneficial when some of our gates have been burnt and certain walls have fallen. Listen to me. There are gates that some have, and they're so tight and so strong that those gates will not open enough to let right believing enter in.
That's right.
There are gates that remain closed to the finished work of Jesus so that they can keep their list of performance. There are gates remaining closed to the grace of God so that the Ten Commandments can rule the day. There are traditions and silly beliefs that have handcuffed believers in trying to live the Christian life without Christ to do it on their own, and then they crash and burn. You know, I read this quote the other day. I won't quote it exactly, but here's what it says. The mindset, there is a mindset so rooted in a religious system, it's like the Jews in captivity, it begins to feel normal. That's what Satan wants things to, Satan wants you to just start feeling, this is the norm. This is the way it's supposed to be. That after, and you feel that way after a while, not realizing there's really something better. Thank God, as the grace message is getting out more and more, many are now running from their captivity and returning to rebuild their faith in the discovery of God's love and grace through the finished work of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, there's only one way to rebuild the walls that have been fallen and the gates that have been burned, and that is only by the grace of God through His Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Now listen, I don't know what you might be facing today. I know what Maney's facing. I know what Troy's facing. I know what Judy Branham's facing today. I know what all these folks are facing. And you can relate with me, because if you've gone through the experience that they're experiencing now, you know exactly how they feel. Amen? We feel their pain. We literally do. If you're in a struggle with addictions today, if you're in a struggle repeating the same sin over and over again and starting to get you down, if you're in doubt of what Jesus did for you at Calvary, you feel like your gates are burnt and your walls are starting to fall down, well, today, right now, at this very instant, it's time to make the change. Amen? It's time to come back. Run to the grace of God. That's what the prodigal son did. Oh, I bet you he didn't just always, he wasn't always trying to walk home. I bet he was trying to jog a little bit with what strength they had left. If he could have found a bicycle with training wheels, he'd have got on that. Amen? Glory to God. I won't forget when I'd been away in my life for 10 years. That day, oh, that blessed day when I wanted to come back. There he was. Been with me all along. Everywhere I had been, Jesus had been. Ladies and gentlemen, I know you get the picture. Christ will never leave us. He abides with us. We are in Him. He's in us. Sometimes we can get off the rails, can't we? Amen? Yeah. Come on, lift your heads up here. Look at me. We can jump off the rails, can't we? Things can go awry. I got good news for you today. He will not hold that against you. Because there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Are you in Christ today? If you're in Christ, oh, let me tell you, you're in relationship with Him. There was a day in your life that you said, I do. And He did. And that marriage is just as tight today as it was in the beginning. This week, I've heard of folks, I've been asked to pray for folks with drug addiction. I've been asked to pray for people with sickness. I've been asked to pray for people that's suffering discouragement. I've been asked to pray for people that just found out they've got breast cancer. I preached a funeral this week. There's probably going to be another one very soon. Some gates that are burned are self-inflicted. If you're doing drugs, you need to stop. If you're an alcoholic, you need to straighten up. Amen. You're hurting yourself. You're hurting your family. Some of these are the attacks by satanic forces. Some are the results of just living in a fallen world. These gates that are burned and walls that are falling. But you know what? Our gates can be renewed today. Our walls can be rebuilt. And it'll be rebuilt by the grace of God. When you believe, when you will trust the grace, God's unmerited favor, God's love toward you, when you will trust Him fully, saying, Lord, God, I've got to admit it. I cannot do this on my own. I've got to have You. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Let's have a song this morning, Brother Ray. Heavenly Father, thank You for Your word today. Thank You, Lord, that even though we have experienced burnt gates and fallen walls, Lord, Father, You're able to rebuild that today. And I pray, Lord, if there's one in this building today that would like to come and pray, Father, they're invited to come forward at this time. And Father, we'll welcome them here. And Lord, we'll just put our spiritual arm around them. We'll love them, Lord. And Father, we'll pray with them. And Lord, I pray that You will bring the answer today. Father, for those listening in our video audience, we pray for them today, whatever their needs would be, that they'll be met in Christ. Save that one nearest hell today, Father, I pray. And I ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, Amen. Would you stand to your feet this morning? If you'd like to come and pray, I'll be glad to meet you here. Maybe you'd just like to come and pray for another loved one. Maybe some of the folks we've mentioned this morning, you'd just like to have special prayer for them again.
Why don't you do that? Why don't you just come forward and pray? Whatever that need is, we'll meet you here. And if you'd prefer to stay at your seat, that's fine too. It's not special to come forward. There's nothing up here that's going to change anything. It's the same God back there as He is right here. But you know what? If you come up here, we'll know about it and we can help you pray. Amen?
All right, brother, go ahead.
Thank you, Lord, for saving.